JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for August the 12th. I am Charalambos, Pissouros, head of research here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar pulled back against all the other major currencies on Wednesday and during the Asian session Thursday. The main gainers were NZD, AUD, GBP and JPY in that order, while the currency that decked out the least gains was the Swiss franc. Now, the weakening of the US dollar combined with the strengthening of the risk-linked Kiwi and Aussie suggests that markets traded in a risk-on manner yesterday and today in Asia. Indeed, looking at the performance of major global indices, we see that the EU ones were a sea of green, with the appetite rolling into the US session as well. Although Nasdaq slid somewhat, both the Dow Jones and the S&P 500 climbed higher, hitting fresh record highs. That said, sentiment softened during the Asian session today, perhaps as fears over the fast spreading of the coronavirus in the continent remain elevated. The catalyst behind the pause in the greenback's latest uptrend and the boost in the broader market sentiment may have been the US CPIs for July, released yesterday. The headline year-over-year rate held steady at 5.4%, while the core one slid to 4.3% from 4.5%, as expected. Looking at the details, though, we see that on a month-over-month basis, both the headline and underlying inflation pressures slowed to 0.5 and 0.3%, both from 0.9%. This was the largest drop in the headline month-over-month rate in 15 months, and may have eased somewhat speculation over an imminent tapering and earlier rate hikes by the Fed, and that's why the dollar slid. According to the Fed Fund futures, the timing of the first rate increase was pushed back to March 2023 from February that year. That said, our own view is that the data does not change the narrative much. Both the year-over-year rates are well above the Fed's inflation target of 2%, and thus it still remains to be seen whether the latest surge was indeed transitory. With that in mind, we would treat the greenback's retreat, yesterday's retreat, as a corrective move rather than a reversal, and we would expect its prevailing uptrend to resume soon. Focus will now turn to the upcoming data and especially the next employment report. I think we would need to see a disappointment there for the tapering time to be pushed towards the end of the year or the beginning of the next. For now, we believe that officials are still willing to start the process in September or October. As far as the equity market is concerned, we believe that it will continue to drift north, whatever market participants anticipate around the Fed. We saw Wall Street hitting records at times when normalization expectations were brought forth, perhaps as investors were rushing to take advantage of low interest rates for as long as possible. But we also saw equities drifting north when such expectations were pushed back. This may have been due to the fact that low interest rates for longer mean low borrowing costs for companies for longer, as well as lower present values for longer. Tonight, during the Asian session Friday, Aussie traders may turn their gaze to Australia's employment report for July. The unemployment rate is expected to have ticked up to 5% from 4.9%, while the net change in employment is forecast to show that the economy has added 30,000 jobs, slightly more than June's 29.1 thousand. Although higher than June, this would still be a weak number, which combined with an uptick in the unemployment rate is likely to keep the RBA dovish and thereby bring the Aussie under renewed selling interest, at least against currencies, the central banks of which are expected to start normalizing their respective policies soon. Now, as for today's events, during the early European morning, we already got the preliminary UK GDP for the second quarter, which rebounded 4.8% quarter over quarter after contracting 1.6% in the first quarter, driving the year over year rate up to 22.2% from -6.1%. This may have added credence to the view that the Bank of England may start tapering its quantitative easing purchases earlier than previously anticipated. From the US, we get the initial jobless claims for last week, and the forecast points to a decline to 375,000 from 385,000. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT time. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.